What we're trying to do is free up teachers' time so that they're not having to be the ones championing the issues of some of their students, that we have someone who is specialised in this area who can help coordinate meeting all of the needs of those kids, free up teacher time, free up their time to teach.
All right, let's bring in our panel now. Josie Pagani, Director of the Council for International Development, Fran O'Sullivan, NZME Head of Business, and John Tamihere, CEO of Whānau Waipareira. Welcome to you all. Let's start with this teachers' announcement. Josie, reasonably significant announcement from a conference. Do you think this was on target? It's going to get the cut-through that they're looking for?
I think no one in the country is going to disagree with this. It's something that is eminently fair and just and will help those families, and everybody will be feeling good about it.
Will the teachers be a bit looked at because of the pay negotiations?
Yeah, well, that's right. Will it stop a strike next week? Probably not. But I think the challenge they've got, and that was an absolutely consummate performance, wasn't it? I mean, she's right on top of her material, statistics and you know, her portfolios and others as well. The challenge they've got is that it's still after a year in government, brand Jacinda, and somehow they've got to shift it from just brand Jacinda to brand Labor. No, but I think, you know, you've got to question how do you actually do that? And I do get the feeling with Jacinda that she's not somebody who is going to feel at all threatened by others shining. That I think the challenge, and when you look at this announcement today on the teachers, the challenge is to sort of announce stuff that is both local, because all politics is local and personal, so how does it affect me, but also universal. And when you look at Labor over you know, many governments, where they've been most successful is where they've had those big universal.
Well, let's talk about one of those, because
like
Kiwi
pension.
Build is starting to get a bit of the wobbles, Fran. I mean, we're seeing left-wing groups attack it now. So, and it's got this issue of middle-class welfare about it.
Yes, it has. And I think going right back to when David Shearer and others really talked about it years ago, you kind of had this sort of vision that it was going to be the state organisation that would actually get out and build the actual houses itself, and that somehow, this is how I perceived it back in the day, that it would be like an SOE, that it would be fully formed, it would have a balance sheet, it would actually employ people and do it, bring them in from offshore if needed. And actually I think that's almost what's needed, because all you've got now is really the state going out and getting behind financing and otherwise, you know, really work that should be happening anyway and is happening by other builders. It's not increasing the sum total, and somewhere you need to just get that, you know,
would there be a problem, John, if there wasn't a growing waiting list for social housing? This just seems extraordinary that, you know, you've got a big spike in the numbers of people homeless.
Yeah, look, I think just following on from where Fran left off, not only is there a crisis, this is one of the largest market failures we've seen in New Zealand history. We built more houses between 1938 and 1948 on a pro rata regime. We fought a war in between.
But shouldn't you deal with the most vulnerable first?
Well, here's the thing. They're going to have to start targeting the bottom end of town a lot quicker. And Kiwi Build was a promise that we're here for everybody. But ultimately, you've got to be targeting the bottom end of town first. Because if you don't do that, your adverse costs, your deficit costs, health, police, justice, prisons, they start to spiral out of, and then disaffection in other communities. So you've got to actually put a wrapper around that group. It's not a huge group.
Well, it's interesting that when you mentioned David Shearer, Fran, when they first launched this policy under David Shearer, I think they were meant to be about $300,000, so they've doubled to $600,000 now, so therefore you get this accusation of sort of middle-class welfare. And, I mean, I think she dealt with that well in the sense that she's saying, well, part of our values is everybody deserves a home, and the squeezed middle deserve one too. I think the problem they've had is that they've conflated homelessness and the failure of the housing market and the social need with this other problem, which is more middle-class
wealth. First-time buyers.
And there has been quite a lot recently about the sort of middle-class nature of Labor parties generally. You know,
politically, is it probably a reasonably smart strategy?
Well, politically, she's trying to own the middle ground, and that's really what she needs for the next election. I mean, if that middle ground disappears off to national...
But where they're vulnerable on the middle ground is, is cost of living, right? I mean,
yes.
We are seeing some real costs coming through, electricity, petrol, all sorts of things. That is a real threat to this government.
It is is a threat to the government, but I mean, we're going to see, potentially, we don't know what's going to happen with the international oil price, but I mean, it has been spiralling up. We've been at this level before, and we've been in relatively benign economic circumstances. We might actually, you know, depending on what happens with the midterms, and I guess we'll talk about that soon, but there could well be economic consequences from that as well.
And the interesting thing is, I think that that middle, you think of that middle as being quite tepid and not particularly radical. I think they're incredibly motivated by cost of living, the concentration of wealth being in the 0.1%.
Well, we saw how quickly Jacinda Ardern reacted with petrol. You know, it was a very strong response, wasn't it? Fleeced. I mean, that was language we hadn't heard.
Look, but there's the truth.
Mainly by the revenue.
But there's the truth. See, everybody in this country knows that somebody catches a cold somewhere up in Saudi Arabia, and regardless...
Yeah, but the petrol tax was also a truth as well, right?
That's another whammy. But here's the thing. As soon as someone catches a cold up there, it goes up straight away at the pump. We all know.
Cost of living is... They know that those... Yeah. Prices, they're vulnerable on that. Yeah. They've had they've done the oil and gas ban, so they don't want to be held accountable for the price of the cost of petrol going up. And I think that's...
And there's other costs too coming through. There's spiralling insurance costs because we're now rated much more vulnerable as a country, and, you know, the earthquake the other day wouldn't have helped. There's a range of local body costs which have actually gone up. So I think you're looking at areas, you know, super annuitants in particular, they're actually...
Well, they need to be finely tuned to that. So let's just bring in, so you've got the political storm of the day, this Czech drug dealer. How damaging could this be for the government? I mean...
I think this will pass. I mean, I don't think it's... It's a sort of blip. I think what you were looking for today, and I think what they need to focus on is again, these big universal ideas. They did actually mention free dental health. Now, that's something that really captures the imagination. And when people feel like you're governing for the many, not just the few, that everybody benefits...
Look at this drug dealer and think, what on earth is going on?
I think people will know that there's a big story.
The Czech guy is a storm in a teacup.
Yeah.
It resonates on talkback.
The reason for that is that there's not enough information being given, and when the Prime Minister says read between the lines, we all know that this guy has past information. We all know that he got a sweetheart deal on a whole range of things.
Well, don't know.
But you know, look, here's the thing. Why should you?
It's inconceivable that he would have been given residency.
Yeah, so here's the thing. Right. Now and then, sometimes you just have to trust your immigration folk that they've made the right decisions for the right trades.
Okay. Thank you, panel. We'll hear more from you a bit later on.